Volume 1 of the Boxing Book Series, Golden Gloved presents Virgil's Revenge featuring Lefty's Slug Fest, written by R.H. Peppers, published by True Grit Fiction, March 5, 2023, narrated by Quinton B. Wells. Prologue. The Ringster, Lexington, Kentucky, present day. Do you think he's dead? He hasn't moved since you kicked him in the face. Shut up all that talk. We don't care if he is or not. He didn't accept Red's deal, so the punk gets what's coming to him. Big Bo scoffed at his large companion, Clay. The two huge men approached Doug Bender on State Street about two blocks from the Lexington Arena, where his fighter, Royce the Wizard Rollins, the hottest lightweight prize fighter on the regional circuit, was preparing to fight. The only problem with tonight's bout was that it's against Luis's the Spider Lopez. Not that Luis is any competition for Doug's fighter. The issue is with his promoter, Red, a self-proclaimed ringster, who thinks he's the next strong-arming Don King of the boxing world. Though he's no king yet, he has influence around the Southeast region like he is, and tonight's venture is to convince Doug that it's in his fighter's best interest to lose this bout to Luis Lopez. Not only lose, in addition go down big by the third round. It would be inconceivable for Royce Rollins to go down in such a manner, but Red was looking to break the bookies this night. There's enough money in it for all of us to be happy, was the message Red sent by way of Big Bo and Clay. Doug wanted nothing to do with any plan of Red's. He honestly couldn't believe Red would approach him with such an indecent proposal, knowing Royce wouldn't cooperate, even if he thought it was the best idea in the world. Royce and the Wizard Rollins is a winner, and nothing short of winning will pacify his incredible hunger. Before Doug could answer, knowing he'd better at least pretend to roll with whatever plan presented, the bigger of the two sizable thugs lunged forward and hit him in the temple with some type of small club. Doug's reaction to the assault wasn't what it would have been if those boys caught him in his heyday. There was a time when he could have taken both men with no problem. He couldn't remember any more than the initial hit that made everything go black. But what he gathered from the little bit of conversation he could hear from the men dragging him was that he'd been stomped out. At least he felt battered as they pulled him by each arm down some unfamiliar alley cluttered with what seemed to be restaurant bins overflowing with garbage. It was the heavy rain saturating his back that brought him to, as the two mongrels kept riffing back and forth. You should have taken Red's offer, you son of a bitch. I could see it in your eyes. It wasn't going to work out, but I got a surprise for you, old man. Your boy is going down anyway. Big Bo screamed arrogantly, then spit on the back of the broken-up manager Clay, and he just dropped face-first into a puddle of murky water. Keenan Thomas, also known as Kiki, to those souls lucky enough to be promoted by Red, tapped on the locker room door of Royce Rollins. Red found Keenan when he was 10 years old, 15 years ago on the young man's mom's job. Keenan's mother was one of Red's favorite go-go dancers at the Sugar Shack in a small town on the outskirts of Nashville, Tennessee. Red noticed the young boy's charming ways when dealing with the other dancers in the club and developed a soft spot for him, which is unusual for his ritually exploitive nature. In a way, he did look to use Keenan, taking him under his wing, nurturing the trustworthy youngster to help manage his employees, bodyguards, boxers, trainers, etc. Now 25 years old, he is the closest person to Red's business, and when Red needs things done right, Kiki is the man he sends. Not waiting, but a few seconds after knocking on the locker room door, Keenan twisted the cold steel doorknob and walked in. With all the people in the room, from Rollins's trainer, cut man to his many homeboys, no one noticed him walk in. A lot of the commotion and debate in the room was about Royce's manager not being there. It seems that it is very unlike him to be late to a bout. While the controversy continued about the missing manager, Keenan took notice of Royce's water bottles sitting next to a sink, away from the chattering group of supporters. He made his way to the sink, pretending to wash his hand, but really plotting on a way to taint the flask of water, which he successfully did with a small vial from his pants pocket. Marcus Cook, Royce Rollins's childhood friend and number one fan, noticed Keenan's slick ass over by the sink washing his hands. He hadn't liked Keenan from the first time they met a few years back, when Royce unwittingly signed a contract with Red that he fought to cancel and won.
Kiki, what are you doing in here? Marcus barked from across the room.
Suddenly, all the small talk in the room died down. Keenan calmly turned off the faucet knobs, shook his hands of their wetness, looked in the mirror and brushed each of his brows before he turned to the crowd of people and put on his million-dollar smile.
Marcus, my man, long time no see, Keenan stated as he pressed past two or three people standing around admiring the half-carat diamond stud in his right front tooth.
Marcus didn't smile back, no surprise to Keenan. He knew Marcus hadn't liked him since they met, for good reason. Very few people in the boxing world liked Red or anybody having something to do with Red. Marcus did shake Keenan's outstretched hand only for reasons of not being as rude as the slick punk's boss.
I was hoping to get a word in with your boy if that wouldn't be a bother,
Keenan asked with a firm grip of his hand, still smiling. Marcus, standing between him and Royce, looked back to confirm if the wizard Rollins wanted to even be concerned with this chump.
Yeah, let his high yellow ass through. It's got to be something good for Red to send his ace hound upstate to talk to us little people.
Royce granted Keenan's passage to Marcus's dismay.
Is there a way for us to have a little more privacy? Keenan requested.
Royce looked around the room and asked everyone but Marcus to wait in the hallway while he and Red's mutt talked.
It won't be a long wait if I know my man here, he said as the group of six or so filed out the room in wonder.
Royce waited for the door to close and lit right into Keenan.
What could be so important that you come interrupt my pre-game meditation? Note, your boss is not someone I have the highest regards for, but you've been cool up to this point, so please make it quick.
First, let me say I appreciate your time, and yes, Red sent me down here to ask you a question.
Keenan paused in an attempt to crop this bribe in a respectful manner, though there was no respectful manner for asking a person to take a dive in a prize fight. He figured the direct approach would be the best option. Let the money speak for itself. Either it will work or not. Besides, Plan B had already been set in play. Red wants to offer you $150,000 to throw the fight by the third round. The prize money is only $40,000 if you win. I know I'm not telling you anything you don't already know, but the offer is on the table.
Royce smirked at the gall of Red again, trying to buy him out. It just didn't make sense, and by the time he reached out and grabbed Keenan by the collar of his silk suit, he was so enraged he couldn't produce the words to convey how he felt about the shady offer.
Marcus quickly separated the two men, knowing Royce didn't need this stress on his mind before the fight, and then physically escorted Keenan to and out the metal door. The crew waiting in the hall stood in shock at the scene barreling through the doorway. One mentioned to another while Keenan took time to straighten his suit with his back to them before walking away.
I told you Royce wasn't in the mood for Red's shit.
Keenan heard the comment as he stepped down the hall with a smile none of them could see on the other side of his slicked back wavy hair. It's the middle of the second round, and I tell you the champ Royce the Wizard Rollins looks way off his game, but it's still early in the fight. One commentator said to the other,
Yeah, I know what you mean, Clark. I was fortunate enough to see Royce Rollins fight a few months back, and he looked nothing like this. The slow pace, the sluggishness, and lack of offense just isn't him.
Let me tell you, Dave, I've seen Rollins fight a number of times, and I'll stretch to say, with much more qualified competition that couldn't lay a glove on him. And for what we see going down before our eye now is amazing.
Well, Clark, luckily for the champ, there's only a couple more seconds in this round. Maybe he and his corner can put a plan together to straighten up this jam.
Royce! Royce, can you hear me? You're getting beat! You need to bring the heat, baby. This scrawny punk can't handle you!
Marcus spoke out to his friend over the crowd noise as he wiped his face and sprayed water on top his head. Royce seemed out of it, there, but not there. His trainer voiced instructions for the next round, but he couldn't distinguish his trainer's advice from the hundreds of people yelling in the stands. When the bell rang for the third round, Royce was slow to get to his feet. Marcus noticed his lethargic pace and wondered what was going on. He'd never seen Royce like this. He started to think, and as he did, he took a look around the stands and spotted the two people he felt could be most responsible for something as cowardly as to drug his partner. There they were,
The fat man with the long red pressed hair in curls covered by a black furry top hat, and his slim high yellow go-boy smiling and laughing at the spectacle they were making of his homeboy.
Can you believe it? The champ is down. You heard me right, folks. The champ is down in the third round.
I'll bet you, no one counted on this happening. Royce, the wizard Rollins suffers the first defeat of his career at the hands of Luis, the spider Lopez, winner by knockout in the middle in the third round. The commentators were so amazed they ran short of catchphrases. Marcus heard the body hit the mat, but was so caught up watching Red and Keenan, he missed the whole exchange. He looked in the ring to see Royce stretched out on the mat, not moving a muscle. Everybody from the Rollins corner jumped in the ring the moment the ref finished his count. Marcus was the first person to him. When he turned Royce over, an orange like foam ran from the corner of his mouth and out from his nose.
Somebody get a doctor!
He screamed at the top of his voice. Chapter 1. The Pugilist, Jolton, Tennessee. I arrived at my old stomping grounds in Jolton around 6 o'clock in the evening, after a hot 3.5 hour bus ride from Covington, where I had spent the past 2 days visiting a few old friends I knew from my years of service in the Army. I hadn't been back in the flatlands of Tennessee in over 20 years. I'm originally from Jacksonville, Florida, the Sunshine State, where I had more fights than opportunities to pick fruit from the variety of countless groves. My mom, bless her heart, chose to enlist me in the Army before my bad habits made a mockery of our family's decent name. On Sinclair, she said, "Virgil, you're going to straighten up your act one way or another. You hear the good Lord speak to you every Sunday, but come Monday, you walk in with the devil, and I don't know no more to do with you. Boy, I know you got all the good in you, but something got you going wrong. You take this little bit of time with these uniformed folks and get your priorities in order. Lord knows they made a man out of your father, and you might not know it, but you got all his qualities. I know he's looking down on you and would have surely went to your backside for all that you're doing. Now that's neither here nor there now. We're gonna put you in a place where these behaviors of yours can do you some good. I'm afraid for you when you at school, and that ain't right. Mama loves, but I got to let you go to be a man." I love that old lady, and even though I was only 17 at the time, I knew she was right. The 3 years I spent in the Army gave me the discipline and self-awareness I had missed most of my life, just as she said. I had uncles who were no more than number runners and jazz musicians, all popular and did well by the family name, but my dad, they say, was the one. People say before I was born and my mom came around, Edgar Sinclair fought at least twice a week to whoever would challenge him in the ring, just to put food on the table. I admired my father, though I never had a chance to play with him growing up. By the time I was an active 5-year-old, he was wheelchair-bound and didn't really think straight. Though the Army made him a better man, according to my mother, people say he came back from the Vietnam War a different man. It wasn't the year's boxing that scrambled his mind, but some type of chemical they thought they'd only sprayed on the enemy. We buried him a few weeks after my 7th birthday. I stayed 3 years in the Army and spent most of my time stationed in Nashville, Tennessee. During my stretch in the service, I developed a reputation in the boxing ring, much like my father. I was willing to fight anybody at 6 feet and 180 pounds. I feared no man. So when my time serving the country was up, me and my best friend Reggie Watts from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, who served with me most of the 3 years, decided to leave and find a place where my boxing skills could get us paid. He'd be my manager and trainer, and I'd be the talent. That's around the time we met Lefty in a little town named Jolton on the outskirts, 20 minutes from Nashville. Lefty was a short, mean German SOB who owned and ran a sizable boxing gym Reggie and I was able to train at. There wasn't much money around, so Reggie and I both picked up odd jobs until we were ready to go pro. Lefty seemed to be a monster on the surface, but once we got to know him better, he showed to have the heart of a fatherly bear. It probably didn't help that both his shins were blown off by a landmine in the same war that forsaken my pops. Like my dad, Lefty was a slugger in his heyday and decided to open a gym since his individual career was stunted. No pun intended. When the bus came to a complete stop,
I looked out the window and noticed the sun setting and the streetlights flickering on one at a time with no set pattern. I was so dog-tired by the lengthy bus ride, my first concern was to find my favorite bed and breakfast, maybe have a drink, then pass out. Hopefully it was still around. Lefty isn't expecting me until early tomorrow, so I followed my head's first plan. The Pots Ponderosa, not only my favorite bed and breakfast, but that odd job I spoke about, well, this was it. Mr. and Mrs. Potts were kind enough to let me work for a little bit of salary, plus room and board. This was at a time when white folks around these parts wouldn't have anything to do with no black man. But the Potts were good people, and I gave them no reason to feel they made a bad choice by looking out for me. I snuck in the tavern portion of the inn, where I seen Mrs. Potts cleaning some glasses with her back to the bar, and said, "Mama Potts, you got any of that wild turkey a young man can sip on?" Mrs. Potts stopped wiping the glass, then looked in the mirror and saw my face attached to my body sitting on one of her stools. You might have thought she had seen a ghost. She turned around with the biggest smile, then reached over the bar and gave me a huge hug. We both couldn't wipe the smiles off our face. She said, "One double shot of wild turkey coming up." We talked nonstop for about an hour or so until I was unable to keep my eyelids open anymore. The drinks took their toll on me. I learned during our conversation that Mr. Potts had died of a heart attack a number of years back, and Mrs. Potts thought it his wish to keep the bed and breakfast up and running. She said her keeping the routine around the inn helps keep the fond memories of her lovely husband alive. She was always a pleasant soul. I thanked her for the drinks, and she handed me a room key. Then I drug my bags up to my room and retired for the night. Chapter 2. I woke up about 11 o'clock feeling refreshed and ready for the day. Waking up this late isn't normal for me, but these past few days had me drained. I must have put on at least 5 pounds eating barbecue in Covington. I called Lefty to let him know I was on my way over to his gym, and just like that, he started cursing me for being so lazy as to be sleeping into the day the way I had. He could hear that I just got up. He hadn't changed a bit over the last 20 years. Probably still wakes up by 5 o'clock each morning to torture some kid by driving behind him for 3 or 4 miles while they run their hearts out. The thought made me laugh to myself. He told me to hurry down so I could see one of his young, local prospects he wanted to promote in his up-and-coming event. I walked down the stairs to the lounge area and found myself too late for Mama Pot's breakfast and too early for her lunch. Luckily, the old lady was kind enough to put me a little food from breakfast to the side. She always knew how to make me smile. After sucking down the delicious chow, I rushed over to the gym in time to see the very beginning and sudden end of Lefty's Boys exhibition. It was a one-punch knockout. I could see they were heavyweights, and it looked as if Lefty's kid was on the losing end. It was easy to tell because Lefty tore into the one with dreadlocks laid out on the mat, like only he can. The other kid held a confident smirk on his face as he stood in the corner waiting for the count to finish, while at the same time, some tall, light-skinned guy, with a Tommy tooth, cheered on the outer edge of the ring in the same corner of the cocky bald-head boxer. The loud-mouth guy and his wavy hair reminds me of a young, good-looking version of Gregory Hines in the movie Cotton Club, but gave me the impression of being a sneaky weasel. When the victorious fighter made his way out of the ring, Gregory was all over him. He shouted out praise for the boy's performance in Lefty's direction and kept his mouth running the entire time he walked the young man out toward the gym doors. I made eye contact with the heavyweight slugger and he shot me a smirk. What was that about? If he would have hit me with a look like that back in the day, he'd for sure be challenged to step back into the ring to a defeat. I like to think times haven't changed, but my head and body knows different. I turned my attention back to Lefty's problem, just picking himself up from the baby blue canvas. Lefty saw me for the first time and wiped his head clean of sweat as if one of his prayers were finally answered. Lefty finished breaking the pride of the young want-to-be Rasta man who'd just got caught slipping in the ring, though it was no slip that caused him to land on his face. From the few seconds I witnessed of the bout, it looked as if the Rasta had no worry or respect for his opponent, a costly mistake in this sport. I'll bet he learned that lesson today, or maybe he didn't. Some people just don't get it.
too busy thinking about themselves and how good they are. Lefty waddled over to me on specially crafted boots strapped to the nub of his knees. He used to be fairly tall before losing his shins and refused to use any type of wheelchair to assist him getting around, tough as nails. Besides the little bit of side-to-side motion when he stepped, he walked just fine. Me being 6 feet tall, the top of his head measured up to the middle of my chest. "It's good to see you, Styx. How the hell has life been treating you? Boy, you look well enough to go a few rounds, what do you say?" he joked. At least I think he was joking. I've kept myself fit over the years, and I'm from one of those families with a natural physique. Whether we work out or not, every uncle and cousin of mine has a fit body. "Go on somewhere with all that charming talk, old man. You ain't getting me nowhere near that ring with these busted knees of mine and worn out frame," I joked back. He smiled, which was rare, but he and I have that special bond that goes way back. "Come on back to my office, Styx. I need to share with you one of my new bright ideas." I followed Lefty in his lucky black captain's hat to his office and sat down in one of the seats in front of his desk. He sat down behind his desk and let out a sigh. "Did you see what I just thought I saw in the ring out there? Styx, it's not a good thing to see my heavyweight hopeful go down like that so close to tournament time. I honestly thought he'd do better. That young man he fought has been coming around about the last 2 months and hasn't shown much of what he can do. But if this is any indication of his talent, my money on Haggard is good as gone. And you heard that mouthy punk with him. That's Red's young stooge, Kiki. If Red gets his hands on that boy, he's sure to be in the competition next month." He stopped talking and sat back in his chair, knowing he hit a tender spot with me mentioning Red's name. You see, Red and I go almost as far back as Lefty and me, but that's something I'd rather get into later. Thinking about Red always seems to distract my attention. I felt where Lefty was coming from about his fighter, but I didn't look at the situation quite the same. Well, if Haggard would have been paying closer attention to his opponent, I'm sure the fight would have lasted at least the round. Now, why I shared my views about his fighter, not knowing it was a setup, is beyond me. "That's it! The bright idea I had, Styx! You are the perfect person to get Haggard on the right track." I could see it in his eyes. He wasn't going to let me out of this. "Is this why you invited me to the contest so early? I see you're still an old dirty bastard, Lefty. What can I do with that boy in 2 weeks' time? Is he any good?" "You know me better than that, Styx. I still have the eye for talent. He didn't know what he was walking into. That boy he fought has been playing possum. Haggard is good. The only problem is that he thinks he's the only talent in the ring most times. What am I going to do with him in such little time?" Lefty cut me off. "You were the best, I don't have to tell you that. You could make my daughter a prize fighter if you wanted to. All I'm asking you to do is help me on this one. I really need you, Styx." He knew he had me. I couldn't say no. Not to Lefty. And what the hell, I didn't have anything planned for the next few weeks until the tournament anyway. Chapter 3. The Palace. "Here we are. Welcome to the palace," Quinton said with a wide smile as he presented Red's famous home to his bald-head companion. They stepped through the front door, one of the two huge green doors accented with thick gold trim. It was odd to the stranger seeing the doorknob placed in the middle of each door, though he thought it matched the expensive-looking landscape. The whole estate seemed fancy like that to him. On the way to the palace, Kiki explained all the different kinds of facts about Red's life. How long he's been promoting fights and fighters, what he's done for so many boxers who would have never had a chance if not for him, so on and so on. It was easy to hear the admiration he had for the big-time fight promoter. The lengthy instructions on how not to talk to and how not to act around Red hadn't died down until they drove past the electric front gates and up the long, curved driveway. Quinton expressed to the heavyweight how interested Red was going to be in him, and also mentioned how he'd called ahead to let Red know he was going to be arriving at the palace with some new talent. After hearing what happened back at the gym to Lefty's pet, Haggard, he made it sound like Red was actually anxious to meet with the small city's new hopeful recruit. The heavyweight walked in the palace, as he was told it's called so many times, and admitted to himself that the place or palace was impressive. The main living room was wide open, with large steps descending like arena bleachers to a sunk-in floor about 15 feet wide and rounded. Somewhat shaped like a baseball field's diamond, with a fireplace where home plate would be. A series of matching green and tan couches outlined the semicircle on top of the steps looking down toward the fireplace. Above the fireplace was the biggest, flat-screen plasma TV he had ever seen. He thought, this must be the place Red brings his groups of clients and friends to get their center of attention. There were three large, rounded pillars made out of thick, glassed fish tanks, of which were separated 10 feet from one another, cast to the floor, and reached to the ceiling. They looked to be support beams that also divided the front room from what he could see of a fully stocked liquor bar to the back of the room. He knew the tanks were salt water, because Red had every creature the stranger remembered seeing in the movie Finding Nemo, and some creatures he'd never known to exist. The three thick, round structures were nothing short of amazing to him. Quinton tugged on his sleeve and directed him left of the wet bar in the back to what must be the recreational portion of the spacious front room. They walked 30 feet from the front door, passing two huge men playing pool, who stopped to look at who was walking by. Quinton mentioned their names to the stranger as they walked up three short steps closer to where Red would be. The bigger of the two men was named Big Bo, and the other was Clay. Besides the one big pool table in that section of the house, there were two dartboards with built-in monitors and three couches with a few matching chairs for those watching and playing. A wall on the left side of the short staircase separated the room Red was in. He sat in a cushy captain's chair in the middle of the floor, sitting with his back to the two approaching men, as he watched three different plasma screens in the wall, smoking an oversized cigar. With smooth jazz pumping through his state-of-the-art speakers, it wouldn't have been a surprise if he hadn't known they were there. But when the stranger looked on one of the wide screens, he noticed Keenan's powder-blue Jaguar set in the same place they parked outside. Red lowered the sound system's volume and turned off two of the three TV screens, but kept the screen that displayed a different section of the house and its grounds every few seconds. He slowly turned to face them, blowing out a cloud of smoke before starting to speak. "So, Kiki, show me this young man who punched out Haggard with one blow. He must be something." Quinton and the young man stepped between Red and the TVs so he could get a good look at the talent. Red looked to the boxer exactly how so many had described: burly body, bushy red beard with gray streaks, and long red hair that he had pressed straight. His hands were also pudgy like his body, with diamond rings on each index, middle, and pinky finger. Though it was early in the evening with no sun, he had on square, lightly tinted, gold-rimmed glasses, a silky tan with black pinstriped lounging. The sleeves of the jacket in no way covered the clusters of diamonds on his bracelets strapped to each wrist. If he wasn't a big-time promoter, he certainly looked like one. Red smiled at the sight of the young man, as if he had to be a joke, exposing the gold caps on each of his K9s, making him look much like the vampire he's said to be. "Well, you're just a youngster. What do they call you, Babyface Floyd?" A touch of Red's humor to break the ice, an insult here, a little you ain't nothing there. The young man didn't respond to the wise crack, so Red continued, "My son Kiki said he's had his eye on you for a month or so, and thinks you'd work well in my organization. I'm sure he's briefed you on what I'd expect of you if I decided to put you on. Besides all the formalities, there is a very important event coming up in the next few weeks, and if you're as good as Kiki says you are, I'd be willing to sponsor you as a fighter on my ticket. I have a heavyweight already, but from what I hear, I want you." Lefty isn't going to be too happy with the news, being that he knew I hadn't had a heavyweight to contend with Haggard, but if we can work things out, that situation will change. "So how about it, young?" Red paused and for the first time realized Quinton never told him the kid's name. "Pardon me, I didn't catch your name." The young man grew a quick smirk and said, "You can't catch what I haven't thrown." "How's that for a wise crack, you fat bastard?" he thought to himself. He wasn't comfortable with Red because of all the stories he'd heard hanging around Lefty's gym. He wasn't holding anything against him. He just didn't like the idea of being looked upon in the small town as one of Red's boys. "That's funny. You got jokes," Red replied with a forced smile to the young man's comment,
before cutting to the chase. Well, your name isn't as important as an answer to my proposal of hopping on board with us. I can make a champ out of you, boy. So, what do you say? The young man fell quiet again and placed his hand on his chin, closing his eyes as if deep in thought. Mr. Red, with all due respect, I don't box for competition, I just enjoy the workout. I don't know how my body would respond to a lengthy contest. I'm going to have to give it more thought, and hopefully your offer will still be on the table if it's yes.
I can respect that, Red said with disappointment, seeing the young healthy boy, knowing what he could make of him.
Take a few days to think about it. I'm giving a party here on Friday. I want you to attend if it's yes or no. Bring yourself by.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.